I've listened to many speakers before, and yes, similar sentiments. We don't belong to any political organization, but since we are trying to enter into very important free trade agreements, so I will touch you on the Sri Lanka-Pakistan free trade agreement. This was the second free trade agreement Sri Lanka signed, and that was the first free trade agreement Pakistan signed. I thank the management of the OPA for arranging something very, very pertinent and timely at the juncture that Sri Lanka is looking forward to, you know, take off their economic development. The present status: we signed the free trade agreement with Pakistan in 2005. Where Pakistan extended 206 items and Sri Lanka extended 102 items during that period under margin of preference under concessions. Presently, the trade is about $350 million to $450 million. In year 2007, Sri Lanka was doing $50 million worth of exports to Pakistan, and after 10 years, it had just increased by about 20%. It is now standing at $63 million. Correspondingly, Pakistan export about $163 million in 2007 dollars. It had been doubled within 10 years. The balance of trade has gone in favor of Pakistan, 113% gone in favor of Pakistan. Now, a very important factor that people are talking, you should not talk about balance of trade, but why we enter into free trade agreements. As the other speaker said, yes, you have to understand the benefits that your country will get, right, and they will understand and they will work on the benefits that that country will get. Ultimately, it will be a compromise and it will end up with win-win situation. But here I posted this 210 million population is consuming only $63 million of Sri Lankan material, where 20 million, or basically we have only 18 million residing in this country, consume more than $300 million. So where do you go? The peak of the Pakistan trade reached about $450 million in 2013. However, the Sri Lankan exports are below 1% of the total Pakistan imports. And their exports to Sri Lanka is somewhere around 2% of their exports. In early 1980s, where we were, or 70s or 80s, I think the share, the Pakistan imports amounted more than 50% from Sri Lanka. So that has dropped below 1%. Pakistan is going to be the fifth or sixth largest most populous country. At the moment, it's about 210 million. So may touch about 240 million. So basically there is a market. We talk about Indian market, we talk about Chinese market, and certain markets like Indonesia, Pakistan. With the social cultural relationship that we have, yes, that's a big market Sri Lanka could consider for their products. 1970s and 80s, it was contributing to high as 50%, though it has dropped to 1%. Why the trade is not developing, despite having all these relationships, political, social, cultural relationships? Yes, we are not making it tangible, right? And the free trade agreements have become a political tool. That's what I feel. It's basically to show your goodwill, a gesture, a government go and sign a FTA. To show your gesture, the companies go and sign MOUs. What is the ultimatum of it? Whether the Sri Lankans are getting the benefit of it. Also, when I really see, I mean, basically the policy maker is the government. So the government needs to initiate, and the private sector can only follow. What I see is basically, I don't know where it's like bureaucrats, if I call all the public sector. Now, Mr. P.D. Fernando has been the Consul General in Pakistan. I know basically we were not talking about any political matters or anything like that. It was trade and trade and trade when he was the Consul General. So here with Pakistan, one thing is it's like defense. Now, we had the war. Yes, we gave some priority and this country helped Sri Lanka. Now the war is over, right? And we need to convert these trade missions, foreign missions, into a trade mission, right? Now Sri Lanka doesn't want to go through these defense mechanisms and anything like, you know, I mean, convert our foreign missions into trade missions, which is not happening. Now when I walk into my embassy overseas, right, I feel I'm walking to another Sri Lankan. I mean, I'm walking to my country. But I don't get that assistance, right? We talk about all political affairs, but not the trade. With the trade, complain when people walk into, but we don't get any resolution. Similarly, when I walk into the authorities, like Commerce Department, once again, my good friend, Mr. Fidi Fernando, has been the Secretary General there. It is different now. I mean, we are wondering whether they have the authority in order to resolve our issues, because they are the authority, ultimate authority of the free trade agreement. So we as the private sector, we are sandwiched between the policy, public sector, and the targets that we have. When you talk about the macro environment, yes, not only Sri Lanka, like the previous speaker said, Singapore had signed already 20 FTAs and now they are signing 31 FTAs. So this is the environment is changing. So our people, are they aware about it? Right? Countries are entering into trade agreements. Basically for economic reasons. Right? Are we aware about it? Are we having a set of trumps to go and negotiate? Are we sending people with some capacity to negotiate? Are they get the mandate from the political hierarchy? Yes, this is our policy, as the other speaker said. Do we have a national policy in order to carry that policy into the bargaining, into the table? We are in between that. The private sector is sandwiched in between that. Now these countries, you have to understand, Sri Lanka is an island, but Pakistan is, they have many borders. So are we taking the border, I mean cross-border trading? What I always believe is if you want to have a good relationship with the country, you have a good trade relationship. You have trade. With the trade, everything will come. Right? The political relationship, cultural, everything will come with the trade. If you do good business with a good company, you have a nice relationship. Why? How it has come? It has come with the trade. So you should not compromise that. Coming more into the Pakistan Free Trade Agreement, Sri Lanka has just grown from 50 million to 63 million. It's where they have increased their exports by 100%. There are some unilateral violations. Now this is a bi-party agreement. And bilateral trade, I mean, these two countries are involved, but lately there have been unilateral violations from the Pakistan side. And as exporters, we went to every corner. We went to the authority, the Commerce Department under the Minister of Commerce. We went to EDB, we went to the foreign missions, we went to the embassies, but ultimately we never saw the resolution, nor we got our reimbursements. So the exporters suffer, and what the exporters do is they slowly phase out that country. So the objectives of the free trade agreement, increase of exports, where you cannot compromise, will not achieve. Because we need to do it. The government will design the policy, place the policy, and we are the players. The private sector is the engine of the growth, and we have to do our exports. We have to enter into joint ventures. We have to call for foreign direct investments. We have to do trade investments. So we have to do that, the private sector. But private sector cannot stomach everything if the government doesn't support. So we can see clearly the government is not there with us. Whatever the government, the previous or this government or whatever, the public sector or the government is not with the private sector. So what we do is we just go to the mile that we can go and then we phase out. So that's why you can see exports are not increasing in Pakistan and also in total exports are decreasing. There's another very interesting thing. Now, it's not that it's easy to control trade through tariff when you have a free trade agreement. They have unilaterally violated few, but how they control the exports from Sri Lanka or imports to their country? Non-tariff barriers. This is a very heartening thing, right? When we start doing exports, exports are doing well, a particular commodity, and all of a sudden we start getting custom issues, custom valuation issues, quarantine issues, documentation issues, signature verification issues. These are all non-tariff barriers. Through that, there are delays. Timing is important in exports. Your shipment is stuck for weeks and weeks. You pay demurrage. Nobody is helping you, not your foreign mission, not the authority. And you suffer from initial shipments and you phase it out. So the non-tariff barriers, the countries use a lot of non-tariff barriers in controlling their controlling imports, though they sign a free agreement. So that is a matter to be taken. Also, if you violate the agreement, there is no penalty clause. Any contract will have a penal clause, right? Any violation, the injured party will get reimbursed. It doesn't happen. So the contract is not complete. Right, and also another factor is the basket of products. They manipulate the basket of products, like, you know, it's the products where Sri Lanka should have a USP, competitive advantage, should be included in the free trade agreement. Now, if we export all the material to China, everything that Sri Lanka export, still it will be below 1% of Chinese imports. So what are you going through this list of items? Right? Now we know as commodities like tea, coconut rubber, non-traditional products, gems, those should be included in the FTAs, where Sri Lanka will get the advantage. I don't know whether the people who are going to the negotiation tables are carrying a list. What are the main items? What are the main industries? The products, and what are the products that Pakistan is importing from the rest of the world, whether they analyze that in putting forward a list of products. We don't. And also our people, yes, as some of the speakers said, we just go and sign an agreement with the country, that's it. No, you have to see the entire environment. What lines, what products, what industries they are looking forward, what is their policy, what is their master plan. We may not have a master plan, but what is their master plan? How can we get involved with that development? And whether we have certain industries and services get the benefits of their plan, master plan. So we don't have those. We don't do market study. We don't get information from the foreign missions in Sri Lanka. I think every foreign mission in Sri Lanka should have a trade desk. We had different priorities then, now we have different priorities. And there should be experts posted in those. There should be experts with love for the country should be posted in that. If so, we will get the benefits of these free trade agreements. Otherwise, for Sri Lankans to become the highest number of tourists in India and to import nearly about 10% worth of Indian exports, that's a good segment, right? And we consume $300+ million worth of Pakistan material, where they consume only 260 million, 210 million population, 10 times. So these are the factors that you should toss it up and consider in entering into the free trade agreements in future.